Operation Center, ready for the morning briefing, and we're covering topics at both ends of the river. I will start, I'll just introduce people as we go. So after each person, I will jump back in and introduce the next speaker. That being the case, we will begin as we do with Governor Dennis Dugard. Governor?
Thank you, Terry. Thank you, everyone, for being with us today, and again, for your continued coverage of flood-related events. It is very important that residents in the affected areas get information, and you are our means to do that, and I appreciate the help you are giving us to do that. I want to say a special thanks today to Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels, who has been working all day and most of each night last week, helping with this flood response. He's provided leadership and counsel to me during this past week, and it's been very, very helpful and much needed. I will be in the Pierre, Fort Pierre area today. I will be in the Dakota Dunes area tomorrow. Again, focused entirely on flood-related efforts. I'd like to begin by letting you know something that will be restated again, and that is the Corps release schedule has not changed at this time. It continues to be as is has been published in the past. Today, we will be at 85,000 CFS at both Gavin's Point and Oahe. And tomorrow, Oahe will step up to 100. And the day after tomorrow, Gavin's Point will step up to 100. So there is a little bit of time lag, and there's also time lag in a release reaching the levels below Gavin's Point. Of course, the Pierre, Fort Pierre area is immediately below Oahe's release. Conversely, many communities downstream, with the exception of Yankton, are a distance from the release gates, and so it takes time for elevated water to reach them. In Fort Pierre and Pierre, we released news yesterday that asked residents at 1434 or below to be out by 8 p.m. tonight. This again recognizes that the elevation of release is occurring tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. It is not out of any concern for a newly identified safety issue. It is part of the orderly process of removing human life from an area that will become increasingly risky to occupy. So we announced this last night through the press, and law enforcement is going door to door to inform residents, and we're asking them to be out by 8 p.m. tonight in Pierre, Fort Pierre. The levees in the Pierre, Fort Pierre area are continuing to progress. The contractor, Morris Constructions, is working mightily and urgently to complete the levees, and they believe they will be on track to have emergency levees completed in time, and we are grateful for their superhuman effort. In Dakota Dunes, as I've been saying for several days, Dakota Dunes residents should have their property out, their home secured, and be themselves out by this evening, and be ready to be out, as is the case in Pierre, Fort Pierre, for up to a couple of months. And beyond that estimate, we don't know. In Dakota Dunes, we have traffic congestion, and we have to balance the needs of the contractor more closely there because, as I mentioned earlier, the Dakota Dunes area is designed for limited access, and it's designed to slow traffic. And that's the nature of a modern residential area, and we're fighting that as we race against the clock. We have, 10 a.m. this morning, we closed dunes to inbound traffic until 6 p.m. This is consistent with what we did yesterday. We closed dunes at 10 a.m. this morning to inbound traffic until 6 p.m. so trucks can have access. Of course, outbound traffic for residents who are looking to evacuate is still permitted. But again, the goal is to get out by this evening in Dakota Dunes, entirely out, just as it is in Pier. The levee construction continues to make progress in the Dakota Dunes area. We have added some Department of Transportation surveyors to the area, and there are two other private surveyors in the area helping to work with the contractor. So the contractor and the workers have a continuous update on the levels to which they are reaching as the levee is being built. The Corps has given us new data overnight, and I'm talking about the downstream from Gavin's Point communities that will help us create more detailed maps for the communities downstream from Gavin's Point. There are inundation maps for those communities already posted on the website. We will have improved maps, easier to read maps, simpler line drawing maps that will make it easier for people to judge how close they are to the inundation level in their community. And of course, the level in each community will vary based upon how far downstream they are. And the level to which the water will reach will occur at different points in time based upon how far downstream from the release gates they are. So those are the updates I can offer you today. I do want to remind people that safety is the most important thing at this time. We have been working, I think, methodically to protect property, and the levees are designed to do that as well. Now we need to recognize that as the water rises over the next week, and in the Fort Pier area, less than a week, we need to be careful that we do not become complacent if the levees are holding. The force of the Missouri River is mighty. I've been on the Missouri many times, and it's one thing to be in a motorboat, it's another thing to be swimming or in a canoe, and if you get in the water, you know how powerful that river is, and the power and breadth and height of that river is going to unprecedented levels in half a century. Not since the construction of the dams has the height and breadth of the Missouri been this great. So individuals need to be aware that while we hope the levees will provide protection for property, we urge that people not place themselves in danger nor become complacent, because a levee that's holding today is just holding today. Terry?
Thank you, Governor. We'll go to comments from Corps of Engineers representatives both in the Oahe area and in the Gavin's Point area. We'll start upstream at the area of Stosh.
Okay, I'm just going to give the kind of the Oahe update. We're going to talk about outflows again just to reinforce our schedule. The Governor mentioned that it stayed the same, and it has stayed the same, but I want to go over those increases so everyone's still aware. We reinforce those. Tomorrow, June 3rd, at 8 o'clock in the morning, we go up to 100,000 cubic feet per second. On Saturday the 4th, 120. Sunday the 5th, 130. Monday the 6th, 140. Tuesday the 7th, 150. All increases are at 8 o'clock in the morning. As for Lake Oahe, currently we're sitting today at elevation 1618.82. Inflows into the reservoir at 119,000 cubic feet per second. We are scheduled to top out early in July with the current projections at elevation 1619.6, which is 0.4 of a foot below the top of our emergency spillway gates. With that, Lee J has a downstream update.
First, I'll talk the release schedule. Current today's releases are at 85,000 CFS, and that will be that will continue through the 3rd. On June 4th, the releases will increase to 100,000 CFS. and gradually increase on step increases throughout the time period until the 14th of June, at which time we will release 150,000 CFS. Current elevation at midnight last night of the Gavin's Point Reservoir was 1206.49 feet. That is expected to increase slightly over the foreseeable time period, but the rise will remain and be under 1 foot during this event. And that is above the dam. I want to make sure that's clear. That is the reservoir elevation above the dam. Current inflows of the Gavin's Point Dam are projected to be 81,000 CFS. One other thing I want to make clear is that the releases that you get, the release information from the Owyhee Dam, is different than the release schedule at Gavin's Point. So if you go onto the website and look at the release schedule, be sure that you're looking at the correct dam. And all that information is provided for each of the dams in the main stem system, so you want to make sure that you understand the dam in which you're being impacted by and the release schedule for that dam. Overnight, we provided shape files to assist with the local, the state officials when it comes to the production of the increased clarity on the inundation maps. We also provided data that tied information in respect to the flow release schedule to the expected elevation at given points below the Gavin's Point reach. And that information will be posted on the Be Ready website that the state has provided on numerous occasions. Some more information on the levee down in the Gavin's Point area, specifically the Dakota Dunes area. The secondary levee contract award was scheduled for 5 o'clock. The bid was opened at that time. Negotiations later were started at approximately 8 o'clock, and at 11:30 last night, an award was given or awarded the contract to a contractor to begin work on the secondary levee. But I want to stress that coordination between the local officials at that level are being made so that the primary levee that is currently in progress and the secondary levee that will be constructed are not interfering with each other. And they're making coordination so that because of the reduced traffic capabilities of those areas, that those contractors are able to work together and come up with a schedule so that we meet the requirements for the increased flow and protection of those areas. We expect the secondary levee to be completed in 4 days after the start of construction. That's all I have.
Thank you, Lee J. Templeton with the Corps of Engineers. Now we hear from representatives of the three communities that are really the targets of this, even though it affects all of the river as we know it. First, Lori Gill from Pier.
All right, yes, I am Lori Gill. I'm the mayor of Pier. In Pier, infrastructure and public safety remain our top priority. Levee construction, all levees are either at or nearing the final elevation of 1436. Workers are placing plastic on the riverside of the levee system today. Additional levee reinforcement will be completed tomorrow in Steamboat Park. A surveillance plan for both security and structural considerations is underway, and the manpower is being secured and assigned to monitor the system after it is actually built. sandbagging operations in Pier all remain functional at this time. We want to ensure the citizens that we are committed to providing the resources in terms of sandbagging that they will need as they're making their final preparations. Late evening traffic has slowed, and National Guard soldiers are working to create stockpiles. The City of Pier has 200 pallets stockpiled for infrastructure protection should it be needed. I also would ask that anybody from the Pier area that has picked up pallets of sandbags, please return the pallets to any sandbagging operation. We are in short supply of pallets. We can use them back again, so you can drop them off at any of the sandbagging locations. Storm sewer. Work continues on plugging the city's storm sewers to prevent backflow. Work is being completed in the water as the Missouri River has backed up into the lower portion of our storm sewers. We hope to complete that operation today, and city staff is working diligently to get that done. Now, throughout the days that the water level is increasing, we do expect some river water to backflow through our storm sewer system, as the plugging operations will not completely stop the water. We are asking help from our residents to pay special attention to our storm drains and help to report any water that might backflow into the streets. If anyone sees this happening, we welcome your call. You can call City Hall during working hours. If you need to report after working hours, you can call 773-7410 if residents are seeing backflow into the streets. Crews have stockpiled pumps, equipment, and personnel to repair or replace leak prevention systems. This is prevention, and we are securing everything and putting prevention measures in place to handle any unforeseen situation. We continue to look for sites for folks to park campers, RVs, and mobile homes. We've had a lot of questions about that, particularly in the event that we are moving ahead, and as we are, with the voluntary evacuation. Long-term housing continues to be something we're working on. An assessment team is reviewing sites in Pier as we speak to determine if temporary sites or multiple sites can be prepared for campers and mobile homes. And as we secure those sites, we will be getting that word out to the public through the local media. Water. The City of Pier recommends voluntary watering restrictions at this time to reduce the amount of water entering our stormwater system. This is something that all of us in the community can help with that will affect everybody. Examples include lawn watering and car washing. At this time, we're asking residents to refrain from those activities in order, as I said, to reduce the amount of water entering our stormwater system. I want to reiterate that our water system is safe. Our drinking water system is safe, it's protected, and it's operating. Wastewater, final preparations are completed for the wastewater treatment plant's protection levy. So we have that secured at this time. And lastly, public safety, as I said, remains top priority for us. Voluntary evacuation notices were hand-delivered last evening to 285 Pier residents within the affected flood zone. And we are asking residents in the affected areas to please keep your families safe and leave your areas by 8 p.m. tonight. That's the Pier report.
Thank you. Next, we'll hear from Pier Mayor Sam Titbaugh.
Good morning. I want to emphasize the fact that we do have sandbags available in Fort Pier. And as Mayor Gill mentioned, if you can return those pallets that you've used, we appreciate that very much, because we certainly have a need for them. I want to emphasize that safety is the primary concern. Don't take chances and be observant. And if you see things that are happening, either from our storm drains or anything dealing with the levees, please report it. Certainly encourage voluntary evacuation because that's a safety factor, and we want to try to keep people as safe as they can. We are expectant that the levees will be completed in time for the increased water flow, and work is going along quite well on that. When the releases begin to increase by tomorrow and the several days following, as they increase, we can better judge how much they increase with the increased flow, how much the water level increases in connection with the flow. So we'll be watching that very carefully. At the present, we are confident that our utilities, water, sewer, and electric, will continue to be operating. And I urge residents to be conservative on water usage, not because of a supply concern, but to avoid any overloading of our storm or our sewer system. We've had tremendous support and cooperation from everyone, and from FEMA, from the Corps of Engineers, from the state, from the Highway Patrol, from the National Guard, and from all the volunteers, and of course from the governor's office and his staff. And we appreciate that support very much. I urge everyone to continue working together and with law enforcement, as things will get very tense as the water rises, because there are a number of possibilities that are only projections so at this time. So be careful. And thanks to everyone for all the work that you have done. But again, I urge everyone to take every precaution for safety's sake. We'll get through this situation, and we don't want to have any loss of life. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, we'll go to Dakota Dunes for comments from Jeff Dooley. Jeff?
Thank you, Terry. Again, my name is Jeff Dooley. I'm the district manager of the Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District. Well, I just want to frame this for you a little bit, and then I'll just talk to you a little bit about infrastructure and a couple other items. But earlier in this spring, you know, we became cognizant of the river, basically based on we had high levels last year, so we kind of cognizant of it at that time. But the severity of that problem didn't really become apparent until about Tuesday of the May 24th, when the Corps started to come out with some drastically increased and high releases out of Gavin's Point. At that time, on the 24th, we locally just formulated and started implementing an extensive levee project along the Missouri River. And as those releases from the Corps kept increasing to higher levels, the state mobilized their incident command team and has now taken over management of the project we started. And that work continues, and I'll let Joe talk about that a little bit later. But it's an extensive project, a lot of resources. We have over a dozen contractors and subcontractors working on the project, from engineers to dewatering to the dirt work. So thank you to the state and for everybody for helping on that. While they're building a levee, we are also working to secure our infrastructure as it relates to water, sanitary sewer, and storm sewer. We do have a water treatment plant that will be affected by this flooding. We are securing it basically so that when it comes time, we can get it operating sooner. We do have a secondary source of water from the city of Sioux City through a long-term contract. So we'll be counting on them to provide that water for us. On the sanitary sewer, we have two localized local lift stations that we've secured. Again, basically for the purposes of getting them operating again at some point down the road. Our main lift station we're securing and believe is going to be out of the water and functioning. That will allow us to pump sanitary sewer over to Sioux City for treatment. And then we are also preparing to systematically plug the collection system as it becomes necessary, so that the whole system does not become inundated. Our ability to provide water and sewer to to the commercial area and the residential area that's available is really a function of our ability to get that stuff over to Sioux City, and we believe that that Sioux City is working to make sure that those systems are operating. In the long term, we believe that the commercial area in Dakota Dunes will be viable for the next during the duration of this event. In regards to storm sewers, obviously the levees has negated our ability to get stormwater off the property, but we've contracted with a firm to provide those services for us, and those solutions are being implemented in coordination with the incident management team and the levee. So work continues to progress day by day, and we're hoping to be able to get there to match the core releases. Just a couple comments on telecommunication and electricity. Both private firms that own those facilities are working to secure their own facilities to make sure that at least the critical infrastructure has that stuff and that it is available where possible. I just want to make one comment on sandbagging. You know, our residents in Dakota Dunes are continuing to try to sandbag their residents, which is a good plan. But at this point, we're getting down to the point where the best use of your time may not be maybe waiting in line for a sandbag or loading up your truck, but to be home preparing your belongings for possible departure out of the dunes, and also for area residents, not only in Dakota Dunes, Gateway is, we have a big sandbagging operation at Gateway. There's a, and Gateway, you can get sandbags at that location. So I'll stand by for questions.
Thank you, sir. Now we'll come back to the EOC and hear a little broader perspectives on how this is going. First from Christy Terman, Director of the Office of Emergency Management here in Pierre.
Thanks, Jerry. Again, my name is Christy Terman. I'm director of the South Dakota Office of Emergency Management. As I have reported for the past several days, we are continuing to provide critical support to the communities of Pierre and Fort Pierre, Yankton, and Dakota Dunes throughout this flood fight. Just to give you a little bit of perspective on the amount of support that is being provided, I want to go through some resource statistics for you. Approximately 3 million sandbags have been provided to Pierre, Fort Pierre, Yankton, and Dakota Dunes. In addition, Highway Patrol, Game Fish and Parks, and local law enforcement have marshaled an additional 85 officers to support Pierre and Fort Pierre and Dakota Dunes. There are nearly 900 National Guard soldiers and airmen activated on state active duty to assist with flood fighting operations in all communities in Dakota Dunes and Fort Pierre. There are 3 National Guard Blackhawks assigned to flood fighting operations. 2 of those are currently on the ground in Dakota Dunes, assisting with lifting large sandbags onto the levees down there. 1 Blackhawk is en route, and that is a Blackhawk from the state of Utah, and that will be arriving in Dakota Dunes at approximately 1 p.m. this afternoon. In addition to those resources, there are boats, water pumps, and generators and light sets that have been provided to these communities to support any operations such as search and rescue, dewatering, and night operations. So that gives you a little bit of perspective on the types of resources and the number of resources that are being assigned to these communities to assist them with flood fighting. And just to give you a little bit more perspective on the scope of this operation and of this incident, at the state level, we've tapped into 2 systems that we've never tapped into before. South Dakota is a member of the Emergency Management Assistance Compact, and that is our state-to-state mutual aid system, meaning if one state has an emergency, we can work with another state right next door or halfway across the country to bring us specialized resources that we need to respond to the emergency. We have never utilized EMAC before, and we are utilizing EMAC during this incident. So this, for the first time in history, we are bringing in assets through the EMAC system into Assist South Dakota. Also, we have a great partnership with FEMA, and most of you will remember that last year we had a record 7 presidential disaster declarations. Our interaction with FEMA has been in the past primarily to provide reimbursement to repair critical and public infrastructure back to pre-disaster condition. But FEMA can provide a lot more, and in this particular instance, we are authorized to obtain direct federal assistance from FEMA for life-saving activities and damage to public infrastructure. And we are tapping into those assets this time as well. So those are two systems that we have never tapped before, and we are tapping this time. So that gives you a little bit of idea of the scope of this incident. That's all I have to report today.
Thank you, Christy. Now we'll go to Dakota Dunes, where Joe Lowe is incident commander coordinating efforts down there. Joe?
Good morning. This is Joe Lowe. I'm the incident commander for Rocky Mountain Team C, a state-sponsored Type 2 interagency management team. In Yankton, we have embedded team members in Yankton, assisting them in their EOC and supporting their operations. And as we move down, we are going to move down the river. When we get to Vermilion, we are evaluating the homes along the river as to risk potential. And currently we're in the evaluation phase. As we continue to move down river, we get into Union County. I'm going to lump Union County into 3 different areas. Number one, Riverlands Township. We have deployed 50 National Guard troops there. We're using helicopters, a National Guard UH-60 Blackhawk helicopter, in sling loading sandbags in to that area. We have a division group supervisor running operations up there for the team. We moved to Windstone Development in Union County. We deployed a branch director, a field observer, and a field observer, what the field observer does is actually goes out and boots on the ground and verifies that the conditions that are what they are. I do want to say that in Windstone, the homeowners have done a great job in protecting their community. They've taken a lot of action on their own. That is very helpful to all of us, because the more they do in protecting their own property, it takes a little bit of a load off of all of us that are trying to protect levees and things. North Sioux City, when we get down to North Sioux City, we are working with the city manager and city staff and the emergency manager. Right now the roads are at 1106, that's what the road levels are, and houses are just a slightly lower, so we don't view that as a great threat, immediate threat at this time. The public meeting was held last night, and over 600 attended that meeting, that meeting was well attended, and we've done well there. When we move down in Dakota Dunes, that is basically the big push for us, the big operational area. There's the most to lose in this community, and there's a great amount of many structures in here. I think the good news yesterday is we've had a good day yesterday by closing the roadway to trucks only. That was the big push yesterday. And by the end of today, we should have the levee to 1096. With the other roadway closure today. That'll put us a day ahead of schedule where we need to be. We have over 75 pieces of heavy equipment working on the job site out there on the levee. Over 100 trucks are involved in the incident. Aviation assets, as Christy did define before, we have two UH-60 Blackhawk helicopters working currently on the operation. We have ordered a swift water rescue team from Sioux Falls to anticipate any needs. As Lieutenant Governor defined earlier, the river is moving very quickly, and we have people working on levees close to the water, and so we felt it necessary for the entire southern area here to have a swift water rescue team available should somebody go in the river. All infrastructure's needs will be, we look at being protected by the end of the day. And just one thing on use of volunteers and the Gateway sandbag operation, that's going quite well, folks. If we look at this, by the end of the day, the goal is to produce 30,000 sandbags. 80% of those will be for residential use. We have built last night over 6,500 sandbags were built. And we break it down, that station, into three groups. There's a do-it-yourself station where the homeowners can come in and build their own bags. The Department of Transportation is working there and doing quite well. We have 20 National Guardsmen there. And today there will be 400 volunteers coming in from the Sioux City School District. That's the end of my report. And if anyone has any questions, I'm available.
Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that. Finally, before questions, we'll go to Mark Nabeau. He's the Federal Coordinating Officer with FEMA, and he can talk to you a little bit about how FEMA is supporting this whole effort.
Good morning, everyone. Mark Nabeau, Federal Coordinating Officer with FEMA. In these challenging times, you've heard some very, very good news, and that is, as the rivers are planned to rise, the levees are already rising. There's a tremendous amount of work going on in terms of unity between multiple layers of government, and citizens are coming out and supporting their neighbors. Tremendous effort. With regards to the federal government and FEMA, yesterday the president signed an executive order which allows direct federal assistance to counties of Union, Clay, Yankton, and Stanley, adding to Hughes County. What that provides is direct federal assistance for life-saving measures, as well as to protect critical infrastructure, community services. At this point, the state has been able to manage, in partnership with the local, most of the requirements. We are here standing ready. What we have provided is emergency communications equipment. There are some supplies that are staged, for instance, cots, infant supplies, water and meals if necessary. We have a number of personnel on scene helping in a technical assistance role, so we stand by ready at whatever requests the government may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Now we'll go to some questions, and as we did yesterday, we'll start here in the pier area, take a few questions. We'll then open it up for the folks on the phone. So if you'll be patient for just a few moments, we'll start here in Pier.
Tony Mangan from KCCR Radio. Eric, would you walk us through every day between tomorrow and Tuesday? I mean, what are people going to see? There's a perception we're going to see a big wall of water tomorrow. But what are people going to see the next 4 to 5 days as you guys continue to increase the water?
Okay. We know we're going to see over that time period approximately 4 foot rise in water.
It's not going to be a wall of water. It's not going to be a surge of water. You're going to have to be there and watch it come up because it will slowly rise. It takes a little bit of time for that water to get from the dam to here. It's not a lot, like the governor said. But then it takes probably 4 to 6 hours for that elevation to stabilize in this area until we get to a stable pool area in this area. So it's going to be a gradual rise. It's going to come up in over an hour to 4 hour period, and it's going to be staged in 5 stages.
Aaron, what's the elevation level now, and to compare that to how high it's going to get?
Okay.
The next few days.
The river elevation off of our gauges on the river, the gauge heights that we work with, are approximately 1429 and a half today. And that's kind of where they've been ever since we've been doing this 85,000 cubic feet per second. So we're going to see approximately a 4 foot rise over the 5 days on that.
Eric, when the releases reach 150,000, and the water begins to rise, how long after that rate is released will the water rise to where it's gonna stay at that level?
Well, we're going to the 150,000 cubic foot per second on Tuesday, June 7th. So sometime Tuesday afternoon, we're gonna be holding 150,000 cubic feet per second for quite some time. So it's going to be somewhere around then until the end.
Eric, regarding, you have talked about spillway, not using the emergency spillway, but we've had people say that they saw Corps crews out yesterday taking down trees along Highway 1806, that type of thing. Are you preparing for the use of the emergency spillway, or is that something else?
Like the governor pointed out yesterday, what we're doing is we're planning. We're planning for the worst in case it happens, but we don't think we're going to use it right now. What we're doing is there's a railroad grade just east or downstream of Highway 1806 that would have a tendency to divert flow down towards the top of Frontier Road. We don't want to divert that water. We want to get that water into the Missouri River as quickly as possible. So we've taken those trees out, so if it does flow over there, we're not adding to debris downstream. We've hauled that up and out, and now we're in the process of taking that railroad grade down and putting in some ditch plugs to control that water to the river.
What happens, who makes a decision about whether it goes in the emergency spillway? At what time during this 5-day period would it be most likely that it would go to an emergency spillway?
Obviously, the higher the releases, the more probability that it would be going towards there. So after we get to that 150,000 cubic feet per second, from then on is when the probability would be the highest. One of the additional factors, when we're dealing with 100% flow coming out of our outlet structure, and then the rest of that flow coming out of our power plant, we are still relying on Western Area Power to maintain a minimum amount of energy generation so that we can do that. If for some reason that does not happen, we would have to go over to the emergency spillway.
If all goes well and we have no more rain, but we are still at that 150, we wouldn't have to use the spillway, or could something else change the choice or the decision to use the spillway besides weather?
We would have to see a change in the release in the forecast runoff, increases in runoff, increases. If the mountain snowpack came off all of a sudden, I mean, if we just warmed up to 100 degrees and everything started coming off really quickly, that's going to push some models out a little bit. If we got another severe rainstorm, that's going to push models. If we maintain normal and everything happens the way it's anticipated, we are not going to use the spillway.
Charles, you're South Dakota Public Radio. I think you said 119,000 CFS coming in right now. What's the projected maximum CFS at this point in the models we're going to see coming into Oahu?
Do you have your statement?
And when will that sort of peak be reached in the upper Missouri?
Well, and what the thing here is Garrison Dam is going to be going to the 150,000 cubic feet per second also. So we're going to get the incremental flows between Garrison Dam and us above that 150. So we're looking at inflows going above the 150,000 cubic feet per second in the 17th to 18th of June timeframe, and not very far above that, because if weather patterns hold, we're starting to dry out now. We're starting to get out of the rainy season, so the incremental flows from the TRIBs are not going to contribute to that much in the future.
I assume you're hoping by that time at 150,000 here for a few days you'll be able to draw the reservoir down before those increased flows start coming in, so you have some capacity to deal with that.
Exactly. They're not up to 150,000 in Garrison yet, so anything that we can do in front of them and get ahead of them on our releases is obviously good for us. I don't know how much of that's going to happen.
I'd like to ask just on a separate point, what are the weakest points in the levee in pier? What are the weakest points in a temporary levee system like this in general? What are the points you've got to watch out for?
I don't really think we have weak points in our levee system. I think they're designed to be strong through and through. We tie them into a high ground, they're designed to hold.
If you had to, for some reason, had to increase on releases above 150,000, can you build upon those levees if need be, or they're at that height and they're going to stay at that height?
You can always build on top. If for some reason we decided they had to go higher, they could go up.
One more here, and then we'll go to the phones.
One question for the two mayors, the governor and Eric. As the next 4 or 5 days go, what are you personally and leaders going to be watching for? for signs that the levees are holding, that things are going as you anticipated. What are the things that you're going to, in your own mind, are going to be watching to see how this is going?
Well, obviously, the completion of the levee construction is very urgent. But even more important is compliance with safety concerns for individual citizens. As Eric said, the levee designs are made to hold, but if there is a problem with the levees, if they do not hold, and individuals become complacent and put themselves in danger unnecessarily, that will be my concern. I think we need to be ever vigilant and not be too worried about property that we don't take care of ourselves.
Thank you. Now we'll go to the phones, and one thing I think we might do is, if you've been listening to the questions, see if Jeff Dooley has some comments to answer the same questions down there before we start questions. Jeff, are you still there, and do you have any responses that would answer some of the questions they've been asking here?
Not at this point.
Okay. Anyone who wants to ask a question, identify yourself if you would, please.
Hi, this is Jen Youngworth with the Daily Republican Mitchell. And I'm just curious as to what's the flood forecast for the areas between Pier and Yankton, like Chamberlain, for example?
What we're going to be doing, as we stated previously, is that when these releases start up, it's going to be a passing type thing. We're going to be passing these flows through all the structures. So you're going to see this type of flow going by those towns. Lake Francis case is scheduled to increase some over the next few weeks in response to these releases, but I don't think there's any major concerns in that stretch of the river.
Okay. Other questions?
Yeah, this is Jerry, WNIX in Yankton. We took the tour yesterday with Senator Johnson, also have been talking to folks in and around the Dunes area. And what we're hearing a lot about, obviously, people want to know how high is the water. And what we're kind of getting into is a battle of the maps, different maps, the first maps. And now there's been updated maps were handed out yesterday, which showed a higher level of water here. Some of the folks in the Dunes area were hearing that it's going to be 2 feet higher than they were told earlier. Is that a concern with this kind of information out there? I mean, we want to get out what is most accurate and, you know, what is the most accurate at this point? Or is it just a case of maybe nobody really knows for sure?
Jerry, this is Governor Dugard. I would recommend you encourage your listeners to go to the state website. As I mentioned, some of the earlier maps are not as detailed and large as we'd like to have them, and it makes it more difficult for citizens to judge what elevations there are and whether they're inside the affected area or only near it or not at all near it. And most communities downstream from Gavin's that will be affected should have more detailed, more legible maps that will help guide them. And they will be pretty simply showing the level to which we believe the water will reach on the map. And so people can look and say, oh, there's me, I'm in it. Now, I would caution that these times are unprecedented. And so what's happening with the water has never happened before. And so it is a good judgment, but it is not perfect and not entirely precise. So those who find themselves close to the line should exercise an abundance of caution and be conservative in their actions. But that being said, I encourage your listeners to go to BeReadySD.com, and those maps will be posted as soon as we can. We got the information overnight, and our staff at the Department of Environment and Natural Resources are scrambling to put that together as quickly as they can.
And also, Jerry, that link is a link to all of the flood information that we're getting and putting out of your releases and photos and maps and just about anything we can get. So If you can drive people that way, they'll find links to a wealth of information that might help them. Other questions?
This is Jerry with KGFX. I'm wondering if you can tell me if the number of calls that are coming into the Emergency Operations Center from the public, has that been increasing, waning? I mean, do you have a feel for, you know, the number of calls that you're taking in there?
Yeah, Jerry, this is Christy Terman. Early in the week, last week when this operation started, we were hovering at about 300 calls a day. As we have started ramping up, I think we're getting closer to about 500 calls a day.
Are those from, Christy, if I can ask Tony Mangan again, are you, from your standpoint, are they from all over the state, or is it just Pier 4, Pier, and then Yankton? I mean, is there a division, I guess?
Yeah, the calls are primarily from the Pier 4, Pier area, as well as the Dakota Dunes and Yankton area. We're getting a smattering of calls all up and down the Missouri River, but primarily, the calls are from the two areas that are being most heavily impacted.
Thank you. Other questions? Questions on the phone?
Yeah, this is Pete Harriman at the Argus Leader. Is the state, can you describe for me to what level you're planning in depth to deal with unforeseen events? Things like the hospitals in the state, are they being pulled into the planning effort? Emergency, potential emergency ways to get people out of evacuation zones. Talk a little bit about that.
This is Christy Terman with the State Emergency Operations Center. And yes, the two scenarios that you described, Pete, that's exactly the type of planning that we're looking at here at the state EOC. We're trying to plan ahead and think of everything that we possibly can to be ready for. We've pulled in literally representatives from every state agency to be thinking about these things. We've been in contact with the hospital systems, as you said, law enforcement across the state in case we need additional law enforcement, firefighting and EMS assets, disaster mental health, the Red Cross. I mean, every agency that is engaged in disaster response in the state of South Dakota is engaged pretty much right now. So we're trying to think of all those different contingencies so that we have at least have a plan in place for if they do happen or have a path ahead.
Thank you. We're coming back here to the EOC for one last question, and then the governor would like to make just a few closing comments.
Maybe for the two mayors, again, what are you going to be watching for? In your mind, in the last week, has your city's done everything they could do? I mean, are you comfortable that you're ready for any scenario and in the next 5 days or whatever it may be?
On the peer side, this is Peer Mayor Lori Gill. We have been working on preparation, particularly focusing on infrastructure. That would be water, storm drainage system, and wastewater. We have been troubleshooting any possible scenario that we're aware of and putting things in place and acquiring resources to be able to handle things. The other side of that, though, is that we're expecting the unexpected. And so what we have done there is to ensure that we have adequate staffing and shifts available to be able to be standing by and handle anything that will happen over the next 5 days that we're not prepared for. Public safety is also an issue, and we have, as you've heard, been working with other law enforcement agencies to be able to support and supplant what we have available at the Pier Police Department. And then we know we're going to need redundancy with that as we're moving forward. And depending on any unforeseen emergencies that occur, we will bring in other efforts to back us up.
Sam Tidball, Fort Pier. And in Fort Pier, of course, one of the concerns we have is to make sure that the infrastructure remains operating. The other thing is that if there's any need for any problem with the levees, we need to monitor those closely, as well as our storm water system, because we've plugged off most of those, or sealed off the storm drains. And so we'll need to be ready and are ready to be pumping water if we have water above the levees. So we're certainly, I think, we're about as prepared as we can be.
Thank you. Now we'll go to Governor Dugard for just a few closing comments.
Thank you, Terry. I would like to say two things. One is about safety. We've had one injury in Dakota Dunes that I'm aware of, but still no deaths as a consequence of this event. Everyone needs to exercise caution as they move out of their homes and their moving their personal property and pets and family out to safety. I ask you to please be careful driving in congested areas, and we still have congestion in the Dakota Dunes area. Stay clear of construction areas, please. Stay off the levees now and after they're completed. And most of all, stay out of the water in flood-affected areas. It's a mighty mow, as they say, and don't let the river catch you unawares. Go to BeReadySD.com for any questions you have. There's all kinds of information there, from how to construct a sandbag protection, where to go for emergency housing, just about any question you might have. Go to BeReadySD.com. The last thing I want to do is reassure you. The situation is unchanged from the last several days. We're exercising out of an abundance of caution. I'd rather be too careful than take an unnecessary risk. There is time for people to be calm and leave their homes in a deliberate, planful way. That time is growing short, but there is still time. I am hopeful that the levees will be completed and will hold. If the waters reach their maximum level and the levees are successful, we may be able to allow you to return relatively quickly. We're reaching several days that are critical. The levee work will be completed, the affected areas will be evacuated, and the waters will reach their peak. Words cannot describe the outpouring of hard work and support we have seen over the past week. The homeowners who have risen to the occasion, the friends and family who have rallied behind them, the dozens of truck drivers and heavy equipment operators, and thousands of volunteers who have streamed into affected areas to lend their hand, the construction crews who race the clock and continue to race the clock. It is the very best of South Dakota, and we should all be very proud. I know I am. As we near Friday morning, we are not going to let up. We are going to work hard. We are going to act with caution and tranquility. Years from now, we will remember this as the greatest flood in the history of the Missouri. But we'll also remember this. As high as the floodwaters have risen, South Dakota has risen higher.
Thank you, Governor. We'll end that for today, and we will have another daily briefing tomorrow morning. You'll get an advisory about it. Thanks, you all, for being on.